Hello, this is The Bittersweet Life. I'm Katy Sewell. This show is mainly listener-funded. This isn't a place where you're going to hear blaring ads like you would on TV or on terrestrial radio. My voice right now is not going to be suddenly interrupted by some guy talking to you about auto insurance or how to mail order clothes. Tiffany and I have been pitched by companies who want to litter The Bittersweet Life with that kind of advertising so many times, and we have always said no. The money they're offering isn't worth the annoyance to us, and even more importantly, to you. We really believe that. But we do hope that you enjoy this oasis from the loud, overamped tone of commercial marketing enough to throw a dollar into this hat, this imaginary hat that I've just laid out for you. We need funding to keep this show going, and we'd like to have enough to hire a little help. For example, I would love to hire a skilled audio editor to give me a hand sometimes, but we just don't have the funding for it. For the last 10 years, some of you have been listening since the very beginning. I have spent hours and hours every single week getting this show ready, and often that means working very late into the night. I could really use a break sometimes. And that is just the start of a long list of things we wish we could afford to get this beloved little show on a more healthy footing. And we have a goal. We would like to consistently have $1,000 a month or more coming in over on the Patreon. Right now, we're almost to $800 a month. So what do you think? Do you think you can help us get there? For $5 a month or more, you'll get bonus episodes and live meetups. You can even send us a text. And for higher donors, Tiffany will even help you plan your next trip to Rome. There's lots of other things on offer, so go check it out. Visit patreon.com/thebittersweetlifepodcast. There is a link in the notes of this very episode. And back to that idea of no loud blasting ads cutting into the program. I want to read you a note that a listener and new Patreon donor sent recently. Charlotte writes, "I became a member on Patreon today. I love your podcast, and a top reason I listen to your show over the years is the lack of ads. I don't listen to other podcasts as often or as readily due to the annoying number of loud and unpleasant ad interruptions. You spoil us with the near zero ads on your show. Thank you, and keep it up." Do you feel the same as Charlotte? If you do, visit us on patreon.com/thebittersweetlifepodcast. And I want to thank Jess and Melissa and Charlotte and Steve and Miranda for hearing my plea and jumping on board. And all of you who I just named, watch your mailboxes. And I'm talking about your actual real-life mailboxes because I've sent you a little something with my thanks. And now, on to the show. Welcome to Rome. This is The Bittersweet Life with Katy Sewell and Tiffany Parks. Hello, this is The Bittersweet Life. I'm Katy Sewell.
I'm Tiffany Parks.
Tiffany over in Rome, Katy in Seattle. And today, we are going to talk about trying new things, but not just trying new things. Trying things that are a totally different experience once you do them than what you were expecting that experience to be like. We are talking about this in part because I have just started taking pottery class. You know pottery, Tiffany, you've probably seen it done in movies, if not in person, where people are sitting at a wheel and forming beautiful objects with their hands out of...
I definitely seen Ghost, so if you've seen Ghost, you've seen a pottery wheel.
Yeah, a romantic, relaxing experience. I don't know about Rome, but over here in Seattle, it is becoming more and more common to encounter a pottery studio where it's not just people who make pottery for a living, but it's people making pottery for a living while also training people like me to make pottery for fun as a relaxing spot. These kind of places are popping up in different neighborhoods all over the city of Seattle right now. So I don't know if I'm just starting to notice or if pottery is having a moment, but I saw it several times. And you know me, I like to challenge myself. I like to occasionally make myself try something that's outside of my comfort zone. And kind of last year, I inched into that by taking a drawing class, thinking that, like, at least I know how to sort of draw, and maybe this will be harder. But I also picked an instructor who had a kind of more cartoonish style, which is also the style I know how to draw in. So it was definitely me being challenging myself, but keeping myself somewhat comfortable. So when I kept encountering all of these pottery places, I kept thinking, well, maybe that's it. Maybe I should try making pottery. Maybe that would be something different, something challenging, but also relaxing, meditative. I could come back with a whole new bowl and plate set. Anyway, so long story short, it is not like that at all. I had, I haven't gotten to the point where it's relaxing. Granted, I'm only two classes in, but the very first class, I don't think I've been in a classroom setting where I felt more self-doubt in such a long period of time. You know how when you try something new that you really have like no intellectual acumen for, and you, it almost was like, I mean, to put it frankly, the thing that I was the best at was like kneading the dough into a circle or like into a ball shape, you know, like the thing that you would have mastered as a kindergartner. You know? That was what I was the most proficient at. And I had no idea how physically demanding shaping something on a wheel can be. I mean, I'm not going to go into how it's all done because, to be frank, I don't quite understand it just yet. But to get something centered on the wheel, I could do that for 25 minutes, just trying to get the clay centered properly on the wheel. But then to like start to change it into a different shape and keep it centered on the wheel, you have to like physically shove the clay with two different hands in two different directions. While the wheel is spinning really hard, you have to be like basically right on top of it with your whole body force pushing behind it. Otherwise, things will get off kilter, and that's when you see like a bowl all of a sudden like lose a side. Or I can't even tell you how many times my clay just flew off the wheel. You know, it was just, I don't know, describing it can't do it justice. But it was far more physical than I ever expected when you look at those relaxing scenes in the movies. And it was also, I guess, the way you have to move is also so touchy. Like, if you have the clay, let's say, and you finally have it in a shape that resembles a shape that you want, if you release your hands from it too fast, that can throw it off center and ruin it. So you have to like take your hands very slowly away. And even that is just, you know, it is just so hard.
It sounds impossible. And I gotta say, Katy, despite the fact that I grew up watching Ghost, I have never perceived pottery as something relaxing. I don't have any experience with it. I've never tried it. It doesn't seem relaxing to me. So what you're telling me, while it's definitely maybe a little bit more physical than I might have guessed, it's not that surprising to me to find out that it's really hard. To me, it looks hard.
Yeah, and so, it is hard. Very hard. I mean, I should have known. I mean, it's not that I definitely thought it was relaxing. Like, I knew it would be something that would be, like, people practice for years to get good at, right? Of course. So I expected it to be hard. But I also thought it would be sort of enjoyable. I guess
I'm sure it does get enjoyable.
I'm sure it does, too. And I forced myself to go to class yesterday because I was definitely like, do I want to keep doing this? But, of course, I'm going to do the whole thing. But I will say I should have known that I was in for something more challenging than I was expecting when they went around the room on the first day and they basically were like, introduce yourself and tell us what experience you have with doing something like this, you know? And a vast majority of the people there were like, I've never done this before. But there was a group of people who had done it before, and not only that, they had taken the beginner course, which is what I'm in, the last quarter. They were repeating the course. Wow. And that alone on that first moment should have told me like, oh, this is going to be hard. Like, this is going to be really, really hard. But I did go for day number two, and we learned how to trim the thing that we'd thrown. the week before, which, you know, I saved some things that I threw. Whether they were worth saving, I don't know.
When you say that I threw...
Through, I don't even know if that's the right terminology, but where, you know, where you form it into something, you, I don't know.
I formed it
into a thing that represents, it does just represent, resembles a mug.
I think represent maybe is the better word.
It represents the idea of a mug. Yeah. Anyway, and I set it aside, and it kind of dried out ever so slightly day by day in the week between the two classes. But then yesterday we learned how to trim it. So you trim off all the clay that you don't actually want to be there and try to actually help its form a little bit more. And that was a lot more fun. I like trimming more than I like making the thing, because it's like big spools of clay like flinging off to the side on purpose rather than unintentionally.
Now, did you get really dirty?
The first week I did, yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that was just me. I felt like I was just covered in clay. I feel like everybody around me looks so beautiful and delicate, and I'm like covered in wet clay. But yeah, so I don't know. I'm glad I went. And I mean, I think these things are important to do.
Well, yeah, I think it's so good to challenge yourself and try something totally new, because it will force your brain to like be like, I have no idea what I'm doing, and come up with ways to figure it out, which is, it's just a good exercise for your brain, especially when you're, you know, when you're not a young chicken anymore and your brain needs to like be woken up from time to time if we get into our patterns.
Well, you know how I don't think of myself as a perfectionist. In fact, I know I'm not in so many ways in my life. But man, like the general insecurity I felt that first day, feeling like I absolutely, not only do I not understand this, like he just gave me instruction and I'm sitting there going, I cannot remember what he told me to just do with my hands. That kind of insecurity, I feel like I haven't really completely felt since I lived in Rome, I suppose. And like some guys like yelling at me, asking me a question I don't understand. I feel like it was very equivalent to that feeling of just being like, I'm completely out of my depth. How many questions can I ask this teacher before I become that student, you know? The one that's constantly like, I'm sorry, can I ask you another thing? You wanted me to form the bowl, how?
So. Does not sound easy.
Do you have anything like that where you tried something thinking it would be one way and discovered that it was something else?
Kind of, not exactly the same, but I've never been good at drawing. I know this about myself. I'm not even good at like putting on nail polish. Okay. I don't have a lot of control over my hands, apparently. I don't know.
Boy, you'd be terrible at pottery then.
I know. Like I can't wear eyeliner. Like I literally can't wear it because it'll never be the same on one eye as it is on the other eye. And it'll look really wonky, like one eye will be thicker than the other, or one eye will be a little bit too low. So I just don't wear eyeliner because I know I can't do it. And I don't paint my nails because I know I'll just make a big mess. I'll paint my toenails because, you know, toenails, they're further away, like when you're walking around, you know,
you can't
nobody
see
really
them.
Like, you can't see it quite as well, like if you get on the cuticle, like nobody notices. But you know, if you do your nails badly, it looks bad. So I just don't paint my nails and I don't wear eyeliner. And I can't even draw a straight line. I do have nice handwriting, I gotta say.
Yeah, you do.
So I must have some control. But
can I say something before you go on? When it comes to like why you don't paint your nails, I also don't paint my nails. But let me tell you, I could paint them right now and I would have them messed up in like, in like less
than
an hour.
That's my second reason. Yeah. That's my second reason. I cannot sit still long enough for them to dry.
The last time I got my nails done by anybody was on my wedding day, and I did not even make it to the car before I had ruined them enough to have to walk back in and have her redo it. Isn't that terrible?
Same. I'm the same. I'm exactly the same. That's the second reason I stopped doing them. So I know this about myself. I know I'm not good at drawing. However, certain artists, and I don't mean like fine artists, I mean like more illustrative artists, they make it look so easy. What especially gets me are those illustrations of like cities. Do you know what I'm talking about? There's a company, I think it's called The Paper Cities. I'm not sure if that's the exact name. It's an artist and a stationery company. They make the most beautiful like calendars and stationery and beautiful things. And they're almost always like a city, but it's definitely illustrated, right? It's not realistic. And it just looks so easy. And I just feel like, you know, sometimes on Instagram as well, like on social media, they have like a fast, what do you call that, Katy?
Time
Exactly. Like
lapse. Is that what
a time lapse, a
that's
time lapse.
it?
Super fast. And it's like, oh my gosh, this looks so easy. Like, I know I could do this. You
Mm-hmm.
think you get like seduced into this idea that this art form, which is clearly someone's life's work,
Yeah.
is going to be easy, you
Yeah.
know? And for me, I think it's mostly crafty stuff and illustrations that I feel like that has got to be doable. Like, I should be able to do that. And then you sit down with whatever it is, whether it's embroidery or illustration. Those are two things that I feel like I would love to be able to do, or draw something beautifully, even just like the bullet journal. I don't know if you're familiar with what the bullet journal is, but you've probably seen it. And like, you don't have to be an artist to have a pretty bullet journal, but you have to be able to draw a leaf, you know, like a respectable leaf. Like, you have to be able to draw some kind of like a pumpkin, you know. And I used to try to keep a bullet journal. And I used to try, okay, it's October, let me draw a little pumpkin in the corner. And it's like, Tiffany, don't do it,
Oh
because
my
it's just
gosh.
gonna, it's gonna ruin it. It's gonna look so bad that when you see it, you're gonna hate yourself. Like, it's just gonna be so
This
horrible.
makes me want to like challenge you to when we post this episode, when this episode goes up on Monday and everyone's listening to it, that on Instagram you post in our stories a picture of a pumpkin that you drew.
Oh, God.
I'm dying to see it. Will you do
Oh,
it? Will you draw a
well,
pumpkin?
I can try to draw a pumpkin, or
Okay.
I can pull out one of my old bullet journals and just like
Okay.
show you like my old attempts that I
Sure.
actually put in ink that like was not erasable. And
Yeah, okay, do that. That's very funny. That's very funny. It reminds me of when I have a very fine artist friend who does amazing paintings, and you know, occasionally people will ask her, "How long did that painting take you to do?" And she'll be like, "Well, I mean, the painting itself probably took about 5 hours, but also an entire fine arts education and about 27 years of practice. It took me my whole lifetime to be able to do that in 5 hours."
Of
So.
course. Yes, for sure, for sure. And then that brings me actually to my other thought when you were talking, which is that when you hear someone playing a musical instrument, now I don't think it sounds easy when it's a musical instrument. I don't get the same sense of like, oh, I should be able to dash off a perfectly scaled drawing of Amsterdam, or I should be able to, you know, create a little bowl. Like, how hard can it be? You know, I don't get that sense, but you do get the sense that it must be so much fun to do that. I don't get the relaxing sense from the pottery wheel, but I get the sense of like playing the violin, like just picking up a violin. It feels like when you're doing it at that level, it should be effortless.
You're not concentrating on, like, what am I doing? You're interacting with, say, the other musicians on the stage, watching the crowd and singing or something while you're playing something else. You know, it's just
Right.
that kind of ease, yeah.
Right. Yeah. And I mean, I don't think, I mean, obviously, I think that I don't know. I'd have to talk with a classical instrumentalist. I know as a singer, it was never e easy for me. I never felt that it was easy, especially like in a performance. There was always nerves and all of that. But I think that it's like kind of a myth. Like, I think that, you know, we look at these people, that the fact that they're artists or experts, the fact that they're able to make it look easy is what shows their mastery. And that could be said for dancers too. Like, have you ever watched a ballerina on stage? And it's just like, it looks like she was born doing that. It looks like that is her natural way of moving. And the truth is, it takes a ton of energy, not just a lifetime of practice and study, but even that moment, it's got, you know, it's not easy what they're doing.
No, I don't think ballet looks easy. I have that the opposite feeling. I feel just by the sh I when I was a little kid, I had a friend who was in ballet, and one day I asked her if I could try on her point shoes, and I tried them on, and I was like wandering around on my tiptoes, and I was like, this hurts so much that I have forever since then not thought it was easy. I mean,
Yeah.
you had talked about playing the piano as I think during our maybe New Year's resolution episode, or I don't know, sometime recently. I mean,
no, it was the episode we did on discovering your passions. Can you miss discovering your passions?
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's it. That's it. Is that something you still haven't done yet, I assume?
I still haven't done it. You still haven't done it. And every time I really, because I was really, really good at practicing the first quarter of the year and even some of last year. Like, I don't know about other people, but I'm really good at doing stuff in the wintertime.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a active winter person and a lazy summer person. So that's my excuse that I'm giving myself right now. But
fair enough.
I was doing quite regular practice, and I loved it. I love how it makes me feel when I'm doing it. Mm-hmm. It just makes me happy, even if I'm like very basic. But I haven't been doing it lately. And in fact, every time Aurelio finishes practicing and I close the piano, there's this little voice. It's like, you could practice right now, you know?
Like, and then the second little voice is like, eh. Yeah.
Yeah. But you don't feel like it. Yeah. So we'll see about that. But, you know, it's funny because my niece, she doesn't really play the piano anymore because she's got all sorts of other things going on. But she was playing the piano like Aurelio, first grade, second grade, third grade, all through elementary school. And my nephew, who's 2 years older than her, was at the same time learning to play the guitar. And she's this was when they were a bit younger, so I don't want to pigeonhole them now that they're both mid-teenagers, but she's very conscientious. She's a really hard worker. And he's more of like, you know, whatever, I'll do, you know, I'll do this for a while. And then he gets bored and changes things and he's mm-hmm. not, you know, but she's very driven. And she'd be practicing and doing her piano and he'd be trying it with his guitar. And I think it was my mom who said to me that he said, oh, well, of course she's good at piano. Piano's so much easier than guitar. Like, it's so much easier.
Yeah.
And I think his mom was like, okay, then why don't you stop playing the guitar and you can start piano? And he's like, yeah, I'm going to do that. It's going to be so much easier. And he sat down and, you know, started taking piano lessons and was like, what? What? I have to do 10 different things at the same time.
Yeah.
So it's easy to look at something else and be like, oh, that looks so easy. And for me I studied piano as a child a little bit and then studied more recently a little bit. But I look at the guitar and I think, wow, that looks so much easier. So I had Claudio teach me a couple of chords on the guitar. And I was like, this is the most painful thing ever. Like, it's painful. I did not expect pressing the strings of a guitar down. I did not expect it to be painful.
Yeah, I know. I felt the same way when I tried playing the guitar once. Once, by the way.
Yeah. I was like, I'm never doing this. I am never going to do this. I had all these like, oh, I know enough about music. I'll pick this up. I'll pick this up in an hour.
I guess I'm like, maybe the takeaway from this is that nothing comes in an hour. Nothing.
Well, no, I didn't honestly think it would come in an hour. Another thing I've always, always dreamed of being able to play is a string instrument. I mean, I've always loved the idea, like I said, of playing the violin or the cello, more likely the violin. I think if you look at someone playing the violin, I think it really can look easy if it's a truly great player. They can make it just look like, you know, it's like, how hard can that be? You know, I mean, you know, rationally, it's hard. You know, it's got to be hard, but there's something about it, the way that they make it look so easy. That's what I mean about the dancer. I know being a dancer is hard, but when you can make it look effortless, it's so amazing to watch someone do something so difficult and make it look effortless. And I remember somebody telling me that when you learn the violin, it takes like 2 years just to develop a decent sounding tone. Just playing one note is going to sound awful for about 2 years.
Yes. I can remember my sister learning to play the violin.
And you can attest to that fact.
Well, I don't know. I could definitely, and no offense, Sarah, I could definitely tell what song she was playing. Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, for instance. But was it ever on tone? Not that I can recall. Yeah, I don't know how long she did it. No, I mean, I would totally expect that. It's funny because I, It must have something to do with your own personal experiences too, because, you know, I would look at somebody playing the violin and think, wow, that must be so hard. But maybe that's because I had a grandfather who played the fiddle. And so I got to see up close, like how much he's doing with his hands and stuff. And same with you, like thinking, well, I know how hard dancing is. And then I might watch it and be like, how easy, look at them doing that swing dancing. It's so cool. But I also think, like, going back to that story about your niece and nephew, some of that's got to be about passion. Like, you'd have to have some kind of passion for it to push through the 2 years that you can't get a good tone on the violin. Or maybe your niece is, like, slightly more passionate about this than your nephew is. And he would rather be doing something else, really. You know, and this is a thing that actually taps into something for her. And for me, in trying all these new things, how do you get struck by the thing that you're going to be so passionate about that you are willing to, like, put up with the failing and the failing and the failing and the failing and the failing? Because all of these things take a bunch of failing. I mean, the pottery guy has said a million times, like, in the 2 days we've been there, you have to break stuff. Stuff has to go awry. Like, you have to lose the bottom of a pot you've been carefully crafting for, like, the last hour to realize what it feels like when it's about to go. You know, it's just part of the process of, yeah, you're going to break things over and over and over. And that's how you will figure out how not to break stuff in the future. But, you know, you have to also be like, this hits me in some way that I'm going to break all those pots to figure this out, you know?
Right.
And it juries out on whether or not I will feel that way by the end of this class. I mean, I still have a lot of weeks to go. This is not just like a pop in at the community center and have a night of making pots. No, it's a commitment. It's like,
how many classes is it?
I think it's like eight. Eight.
Ooh, yeah. That's a lot.
Mm-hmm.
That's a lot. Yeah. You have to fail. Reminds me of, I can't remember right off the top of my head who said it, but some famous writer like Stephen King. I don't think it was Stephen King, but somebody like that said, in order to be a good writer, first you have to write, again, I can't remember the number. It's like, you have to write 1,000,000 bad words.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to write, a large number of really garbage sentences and whatever, phrases, books, words, until it starts to be good. It's probably the case for any art or any, you know, anything really.
Yeah, anything. Yeah. And that's the other thing too, is that sometimes you kind of naturally practice stuff on your own. You know, as long as I can remember, I was trying to write stuff. And that wasn't because people were like, why don't you sit down and write us a book? You know, it was just, you get into English class and you're like, oh, thank goodness. Like, whew, yeah, let's write something. You know, rather than like walking into math class and being like, do this ditto of all these problems. I'd be like, oh gosh, no. It's more fun somehow. That's the thing. You know, I'm just trying to put myself in the way of finding out what those next fun things are. That's it.
I love that about you. I love that about you, that you like do it so purposefully and that you look for these things, because most people don't, I think. And it's a good reminder to put yourself out there and to look for those things. Because like you said, and like we've said in that earlier episode, like you never know what your passion might be until you discover it, right?
Right.
Until you try it.
So true.
Like, we are planning, I mean, it's a loose plan, but we are thinking and talking about going skiing next winter. Because we have some friends who have just decided that they're going to like go every winter. They went this past year. We did not have time to go this year because we had a bunch of other trips. But we're like, we should really try it out next year. And Claudio's never skied, never put on skis in his life. I skied one time when I was 5 years old. First family ski trip. My sister broke her leg. We never went skiing again. Aurelio obviously has never skied. So, you know, this is going to be kind of, to see how do I like it? Am I capable of it? Will I pick it up or will I hate it? Because my friend, we were just having dinner a couple weeks ago with these two groups of friends. And one of them has been skiing for a long time. The other one, it was her first time. And she was describing, and she's very physically fit. So I just assume, you know, she's going to pick this up in like a day. And she said she was describing how hard it was for her and how it was just like a struggle. It was just a real struggle to learn how to ski. And I thought, oh, my gosh. Like,
wait, what did I agree to do this?
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, maybe I'm going to hate it. That thought didn't even occur to me. I'm looking at people skiing downhill on videos. I'm like, how hard could it be?
You just take gravity all the way down to the bottom of the hill. Yeah. Just remember, Tiffany, pizza slice, french fries. That's the important thing to remember. Pizza slice, french fries. Pizza slice, french fries. That's your skis. If you're about to go off the cliff, pizza slice, pizza slice. It'll slow you down.
It'll slow you down. The pizza slice slows you down. And
the french fries are like, let it rip. French fries, pizza slice, french fries.
But I feel like doing the pizza slice, I would like break my knees or something. It scares me.
No, you're not tipping your whole foot. You're just tipping the tips of the skis in.
Just the tips of
the skis. Or you could also take it like pizza slice, french fries. Let's go to the lodge. I hate this.
Well, I might just end up reading in the lodge the whole time. Watching the snowfall.
Also pleasant.
Tiffany here, just popping in. If you are dreaming of coming to Italy, and specifically to coming to Rome, you're probably thinking to yourself, I don't really want to be in those huge groups of tourist hordes trudging through the Vatican museums, sweltering under the sun inside the Colosseum, wandering around the busy tourist streets, seduced into a tourist trap restaurant just because you don't know where else to go and you're tired and you're hot, looking at amazing things, but not really knowing what you're seeing. What's the point of going all the way to Rome and not really seeing it, not seeing the true city, not experiencing what Rome has to offer and really getting to know the city? Because if you don't know Rome very well, or maybe you've been to Rome and you were a little bit overwhelmed by it, couldn't really take it all in, or maybe you've never been there and you don't really know what all the fuss is about, it can be easy to be overwhelmed by a city like Rome. But if you come in October with Katy and me, we can guarantee you that you will get to know this city on a much deeper level. And when you do that, no matter where you're traveling, it makes that time so much more valuable and so much more worthwhile. And I don't know about you, but when I go deep into a place, that place stays with me. So I wanted to share just a little bit with you about what we're going to be doing in October. We're not going to be going to the Vatican. We're not going to be going to the Colosseum or the Forum. Although if you want to go to those places, we will absolutely make that happen for you. And we can set up tours for you. Or if you don't want to go on a tour, you want to go by yourself, we can help you get the tickets. We are happy to do that, but we won't be going there together. We are going to be discovering the lesser known side of Rome. Now, the thing about Rome, what makes Rome so unique as a city, is that some of the churches in this city, some of the small museums and piazzas, if they were in any other city in the world, they would be absolutely the top attractions. But because Rome has so much, Rome has an embarrassment of riches, that even the second, third, fourth tier sites, even those places that hardly anybody goes to, are so incredible. Anywhere else in the world, they would be your number one site. So those are the kind of places we're going to be going. We're going to be seeing medieval frescoes. We're going to be seeing mosaics. We're going to be seeing incredible works of Baroque architecture, paintings by Caravaggio, by Filippino Lippi, by Raphael, churches that are incredibly beautiful, but just far enough off the tourist track that nobody goes there, and will be there alone and will experience these sites in a completely different way than you experience a very, very crowded, busy city. There are some piazzas and streets and narrow alleyways in Rome that even in the height of high season, when you walk down them, you feel like you're in a small medieval city. After living in Rome for, it will be 20 years by October, I know where to go. I know where to take you. I have the greatest amazing secret places that I have been collecting and cataloging and, quite frankly, in a lot of situations, sort of keeping to myself because I don't want them to be ruined. But I do want to share them with you. If you're interested in coming to Rome, if that's something that you've been dreaming of doing for a while, consider coming with Katy and myself this coming October 2024. Because we are going to spend 6 nights, 5 days exploring the unknown, the secret side of Rome. I'm going to be telling the city's stories and really sharing with you what makes this city so unique, and really what makes it the way that it is, why Rome is what it is. So if you're interested, the dates are 6 to 12 October. You can just get in touch with us by email if you'd like more information. Email us at bittersweetlifepodcast@gmail.com. That's bittersweetlifepodcast@gmail.com. We have sold out about half of the rooms, and it's a very small trip, so we don't have a lot of rooms available, but we do have a few left. Please get in touch if you feel like you might be interested in joining us for that magical, unforgettable week. Back to the show.
All right, well, we should leave it there. If you have any experience with anything like this, where you tried something out and it was totally different than you expected, whether you ended up loving it or hating it, I wouldn't mind hearing the story about it. You can send us an email, bittersweetlifepodcast@gmail.com. bittersweetlifepodcast@gmail.com. Or if you're over on the Patreon, I guess, Tiffany, we can now text through the Patreon app to people. So yeah, you can also, if yeah. you're one of our supporting members over there, just send us a text and one of us will reply. And until next time, this is The Bittersweet Life. I'm Katy Sewell.
I'm Tiffany Barks.
Join us again. Bye.